Tony Abbott is now calling out Julia Gillard over what's been an effective tactic lately to say, when she's criticised, she's just a victim of sexism.
This is not about gender. This is about character. And Prime Minister, you have failed the character test.
The opposition leader joins me now. The Prime Minister was still at it on Friday, telling journalists you were a sexist for now attacking her for just speaking up. She must think playing the sexism card works. How do you plan to counter that?
Well, I'm just going to talk about my positive plans, Andrew. And as far as I'm concerned, what last week was all about was the Coalition's positive plans for the future. You can't, on the spur of the moment, publish a book, which I did last week, and so that's what I'll be talking about. And I think that's what people, whether they're male or female, black or white, old or young, I think that's what they want from their government and their alternative government. They want positive plans for a strong and prosperous economy and a safe and secure Australia.
Yeah, but just looking on, it seemed to me that for a month or so you'd been knocked off your natural game by the sexism charge. It seemed to have rattled you a bit. I mean, has it forced you to change your style at all? I noticed in your speech this week you lowered your tone. You were more in sorrow than in anger.
Andrew, I was always going to be focusing more and more on being a credible alternative government and a credible alternative Prime Minister as we got closer to the election. As I said this week, year one of an opposition is about values, year two is about plans, and year three is about policies. And as well as holding the government to account, increasingly as this year has gone on, we've been about developing our positive plans, and that's what this book is all about. Our positive plans for the future.
Your Shadow Attorney General, George Brandis, this week in Parliament said there was, and I quote, a criminal in the lodge. Is he right?
I think that was an interjection across the chamber. George made a very considered speech in the Senate, and then he gave a very full press conference on Friday where he set out in great detail exactly what offences may have been committed arising out of the AWU slush fund scandal. But the point I make, Andrew, is that plainly there's been gravely unethical conduct from the Prime Minister and possibly unlawful conduct.
But there's not a criminal in the lodge as far as you can tell.
Well, I'll leave the serious lawyers to argue about that. The point I make is that the Prime Minister obviously misled the West Australian Corporate Affairs Commission, and the next point I make is that it is unlawful to do that.
What laws do you think she broke exactly?
Well, that's something that George Brandis has gone into in great detail. He's a senior lawyer, a very experienced lawyer, as is Julie Bishop, and I'll leave all of that to them because they're the serious practiced lawyers.
No, but this week, I think this was very interesting and perhaps even disturbing. This week, Julia Gillard was forced to drop her decision to vote against Palestine getting observer status in the UN after MPs, including ministers, warned this would upset Muslim voters in key Labor seats in Sydney. Now, is that a legitimate way to decide our foreign affairs policy on what a small group of Muslims in key seats might think?
For me, Andrew, the disappointing thing about this was that it seemed to put in jeopardy 60-odd years of settled bipartisan policy of rock-solid support for Israel. Now, the Coalition's position is that we should have voted against that United Nations resolution. We should continue to vote against any additional recognition for Palestine until such time as the Palestinians are prepared to unambiguously recognise Israel's right to exist behind secure borders. But the politics of this were, Andrew, that the Prime Minister was rolled by her cabinet and her caucus. Now, it's absolutely unprecedented for a Prime Minister to be rolled by cabinet and caucus on a foreign policy matter, and it just shows that this is a chaotic government, and the Prime Minister's authority is gravely weakened and undermined by
yes,
the events.
Yes, but I'm
of
worried
the
about the fact that some of those ministers rolling her had Muslim votes of 20% in their electorates. Mm. Is this the way to decide foreign policy?
Of course it's not. And again, the point I make, Andrew, is that whether you're Catholic, Protestant, Muslim, atheist, whatever, I think what you're really interested in is good government that takes the pressure off cost of living, which eliminates unnecessary taxes like the carbon tax and the mining tax. I don't believe anyone living in Australia is going to want the Australian government to do anything other than support Australia's national interests. And it's in Australia's national interest to give strong support to Israel.
And we'll get now the book. In the book of speeches that you've launched, when you say, launch it, you're saying you're going positive, building the case for voting for Liberals, not voting just against Labor. What is the most important single difference between Liberal and Labor at the next election?
Well, essentially, we want to take the burdens off people. We trust the Australian people to make good decisions about their lives. This is a government which puts far more trust in officials than it does in citizens. And that's why they want to put on new taxes, we want to take them off. That's why they want to put on new regulations, build new bureaucracies, we want to take the regulations off. We want to get rid of the additional bureaucracies. We are pro-people. They are pro-bureaucrat. That's the essential difference between the contemporary coalition and the contemporary Labor Party.
Tony Abbott, thank you so much for joining us for the last program of the year. Have a great Christmas. See you next year.
I look forward to it, Andrew.